Hi, I'm Erika, one of the senior curriculum managers here at Magoosh and a GMAT expert. Now, if you've watched my video on GMAT scoring, you know how important it is to finish a section and how much not finishing a section or having to guess through a bunch of questions at the end is going to tank your score. But how do you avoid that? How do you ensure that you finish a section? In this video, we're going to talk through four quick tips to sail through the exam and ensure that you finish your sections. All right, tip number one is to have multi-question timing checkpoints. And this actually comes from the two biggest timing mistakes I see students making on the GMAT. So mistake number one is not looking at the clock at all. And that is obviously a problem because you don't know how you're doing. So you could be going way too slow and end up not finishing the section, or you could be going way too fast and be making mistakes and guessing on questions that you actually don't need to be. So not looking at the timer, a mistake. Mistake number two is looking at the timer way too much. So I see a lot of folks who are looking at the timer after every single question, or maybe multiple times per question. And that's also a mistake because one, not every question takes the same amount of time. So that's putting a bunch of stress on yourself that you shouldn't be. But also because it's distracting to look at the clock, right? It takes time every single time you're looking at the timer and it's distracting you from the problem that you're working on. So we also don't want to be doing that. So what we want to do is we want to split the difference and we want to look at the clock at regular intervals that we have predetermined amounts of time for. So the checkpoints that I recommend are for quant, 10 minutes per 5 questions, and for verbal, 11 minutes per 6 questions. So I find that 5 to 6 question range is really nice because it means that you're looking at the clock frequently enough that if you end up going a little bit too slowly, you can recover, or a little bit too fast, you can recover. But it's not so frequent that it becomes distracting, and it's not so frequent that you end up with a good balance, hopefully, of questions that take longer and shorter so that it balances out to roughly the correct amount of time. Now, a quick caveat, I recommend with these checkpoints giving yourself about a 1 to 2 minute buffer. So if you're maybe 1 to 2 minutes over the recommended time for your checkpoint, no big deal, keep doing what you're doing. But if you are more than that behind or more than that ahead, that's when we want to start adjusting our pace so that we don't dig ourselves a hole. All right, tip number two is to have a maximum time spent per question. Now, I know I literally just said that we shouldn't be looking at the clock on every single problem. These are for special occasions. So these are for question types that you know you spend too much time on. That's something that you know about yourself, or for questions where you start working and you're going, I'm not really sure about this. I know I could spin my wheels on this one. I know I could spend way too long here. That's when these are going to come into play. So take quant, for example. So we know that on quant, we're spending approximately or on average 2 minutes per question. And that's what gives us that checkpoint of 10 minutes per 5 questions, right? But we also know that not every question takes the same amount of time. Some might go longer, some might go shorter, and hopefully that balances out. Again, hence that multi-question timing checkpoint. But if we're spending way too long on an individual question, the shorter questions aren't going to balance them out. So what we want to do is have a number where we cut off. So for quant, for me, that number is 3 minutes. And that's the number that I recommend. I do not spend more than 3 minutes on a given math question. And I find that that's enough to get me those questions that deserve a little bit of extra attention, but it's not enough for me to spin my wheels on questions that I'm just going to end up getting wrong anyway. So if I'm working on a question and I hit that marker, I guess based on what I have left and I move on. Now, for verbal, it's a little more complicated. If you've watched my video on 3 tips for a top verbal score, you know that I really recommend spending different amounts of time on different types of verbal questions. And this applies to question maximums as well. So for me, on a sentence correction, I am never going to spend more than 1.5 minutes per question. For critical reasoning, I'm never going to spend more than 3 minutes per question. And then for reading comprehension, it's a little bit tricky because we've got the passages and the questions themselves. But for an individual reading question, I'm never going to spend more than, again, 1.5 minutes. All right, tip number three is to have a minimum time spent per question. So this is kind of the inverse of tip number two. And the reason for this is that there are a lot of questions that when we look at them, we go, I have no idea what to do. This is gonna take me forever. I'm really gonna get wrapped up in this. I'm gonna hit my maximum and I'm still not gonna have the answer. I'm gonna have to guess. I might as well just guess now and move on, right? Save myself some time. And that seems smart, but this test is designed such that there are questions that are gonna look really, really hard, but once we give them just a little bit of time, a little bit of effort, just try a couple of things, they're gonna open right up to us and gonna be easier to handle. So what we wanna do is just give ourselves enough time to give that problem a fair shake and determine, is this actually something that I should be guessing on because I really don't know what to do and can't make any progress here? Or is this one of those sneaky questions that is going to make sense to me and going to be solvable for me, maybe even quickly, if I give it just a little bit of effort? So what I recommend for all question types is a 30 second minimum. So take those 30 seconds to break down the question. No pressure here, right? Break down the question, do what you can with it. And then at the end of those 30 seconds, if you're still feeling like, no, this is a waste of time, then guess, then move on, right? If you're not at that point, okay, then we might wanna just kinda take note of where we're at on the timer so we can apply our maximums later if we need them, and then go ahead and give that problem a shot. So we wanna have maximums, but we also wanna have minimums. All right, and my fourth and final GMAT timing tip is to get comfortable guessing throughout the section for timing. Now, this is a really important tip because it actually comes from and builds on all of these other tips. So thinking about tip number one, multi-question timing checkpoints. What happens if we run over a checkpoint? How do we get back on track? By guessing on questions that we think are gonna take too long and that we think we're still likely to get wrong. Okay, tip number two, question maximums. What happens if we hit our maximum on a question or we're running up on our maximum? We should start preparing to guess so that we can move on. Tip number three, question minimums. What happens when we hit that minimum and we go, this question is still going to take too long. I'm still gonna hit my maximum. I still don't know what I'm doing. I'm still gonna get it wrong. What do? We guess. So guessing is going to be the thing that helps us along the way with all of these timing strategies. So we wanna be comfortable doing it, because if we don't do it, we're gonna be forced into guessing anyway, just at the end of the section. So get comfortable guessing throughout. The way the scoring is built is to accommodate guessing and getting questions wrong. So prioritize your guessing around the things that you think you're gonna get wrong and that are gonna take you too much time. And those are my four GMAT timing tips to help you sail through the exam. Now, if you like this video, I recommend checking out my video on 5 tips to avoid an average GMAT score, where one of the tips is about nailing down your timing strategy. Let us know if this video helped you by liking and subscribe for more videos from me and the other experts here at Magoosh. And if you have any questions or comments or suggestions for future videos, as always, you can leave those in the comments. Thanks for watching, and I'll talk to you soon.